Welcome to Bringing Together the Pieces of Wonder Buffalo, How Artistry and Technology Connect Users to Socially Aware Storytelling. Presented by Technicolor, with Christine Berg, writer and director, Brian Frager, lead experience producer, Technicolor Experience Center, Scott Gershon, creative director, The Sound Lab at Technicolor, and Rainer Gombos, founder, Realtra.
Steal this mic. Hi, everybody, and welcome. So we have such an intimate situation today, so I invite you guys to come up, and let's just make you guys part of this conversation right away. Come on over, and you'll get a chance to chat with our technologists and our artists across this really wonderful project. It really is a real effort to connect the dots across artistic mediums, to address, it's a beautiful display of cross-cultural communications, intergenerational conflict resolution, or at least an attempt to address some of these things. It's what storytelling ought to be, and in a medium that is just completely modern. And so what I wanted to do is sort of go across my guests and have them tell just a little bit about what it is that got them involved with in this project. And Christine, let me start with you and just tell me a little bit, describe for us the project that you wrote and then co-wrote and then directed, and we'll go and we'll hear the different perspectives from the other contributors to this wonderful, wonderful project.
Hi, everybody. Well, originally, Wonder Buffalo was a script for a short film about a mother and daughter with body image problems and how the daughter was going to solve accepting herself. And then at that point, the VR wasn't even something I was thinking of doing. It was what everybody else was doing. And then I was approached by the Entertainment Technology Center, and they had mentioned that we can fund your film if you agree to do a VR aspect to it. And I didn't hesitate to say yes. I wanted to make my movie, but also being someone who's really into video games, this was a new opportunity for me to do a project in a way that I've never done before.
And Christine, this is a very personal story, right? I mean, this is something that's, and tell us a little bit about the story itself.
Okay, so I was born in Bangkok, Thailand, and I grew up as a military brat. So my mother was Thai, and I was first generation American. And throughout my childhood, I was a pretty chubby girl, and that seemed to be the only thing we ever talked about. Uh-huh. Was what I could and couldn't be if I did or didn't lose the weight. Uh-huh. And that had its ramifications through adulthood. Mm-hmm. And even, you know, approaching a certain age now, in my storytelling and writing, I try to think back, how do I tell that story that solves, that resolves what happened with my mother and I?
Yeah.
And I just kept pointing my finger at her.
Yeah.
And then I met my writing partner, Simon, and as we got to know each other, he realized that I needed to point the finger back at myself. Mm. And then that's where the story bloomed from. This is a story of self-acceptance.
Yes.
And that's how, and so I just thought that if I could tell that story and it be a universal story, not just a Thai American story, that whether it reaches somebody my age or someone younger, that it might just be one moment of them going on a journey of loving themselves.
It's such an emotional path. And it's an opportunity to sit in your shoes, to be in that environment, to be that person. I think that's one of the unique characteristics. Good storytelling does that, but to harness technology to make that happen,
exactly,
does put you in that very emotional place. By the way, the experience is available in the booth at the Technicolor booth on the show floor. I invite you guys to immerse yourselves in the story and to share what Christine has gone through, and it's in a lot of ways an uplifting story too. And as we go through it, I think it's interesting. Rainer, I wanted to go to you because we have one of the wonderful things about exploring virtual reality and immersive storytelling is that it brings together sort of the left and right brained people to tell, you know, to bring this forward. As you received the mission, as you participated in this story, describe your contribution and how you mapped your contribution to the story that we wanted to get told here.
Right. So I think originally we were introduced through Lindsay, so someone at USC, and then Drew and I think you and Lindsay came to my house, and you needed somebody who had done some reality capture before, and you heard that I had some experience with that. And I think that's how we got together originally. And then you shared the script with me, because we knew it was a project where there wouldn't be much compensation for. So we kind of it was good to have a really strong script there, because then you know, that got me really passionate about the project. So there was some help needed for going with the idea of doing the virtual reality experience as real as possible, so that it would fit with the short movie that Christine you were doing, and you know, we wanted to use the same sets, and then ideally the actors, and the alternative maybe would have been to do like T poses and recreate like the actors, or maybe do a 360 experience. And I think you were not so interested about doing something like that. You know, why did they find me? Well, I think originally it came through my connection with 8i. I was very involved in 8i. I kind of helped establish 8i in Los Angeles. 8i is a volumetric video company. Before that, I was working in visual effects. So my background is in visual effects, also in real-time graphics a little bit, and that brought me to the project. And I'm happy that it turned out so nicely.
Yeah. It did. And you know, one of the nice things, Brian, one of the interesting aspects of it is that within the context of multimedia, this is multimedia, right? We have live action. We have different types of virtual reality experiences. It's like life. Life does not move in one direction and one direction only, right? It has its twists and turns. It's one of those really, I think it's one of the exciting aspects of how this project came to be. Tell me a little bit about the workflow issues. Describe your contribution and talk about how we put these different pieces together of this extraordinary story.
Sure. We definitely worked backwards from the themes and the final takeaways that Christine wanted the audience to have coming out of the experience, which is really, I guess, step one for understanding what technology serves any project in VR, because there's so many different roads or paths you can take, as you guys can see from all the cool demos out there. So in understanding what she was trying to tell with the short film, which was about body positivity and escaping into your imagination as a means of allowing you freedom, we thought VR would be a really cool way to give the user a peek inside of her imagination, and to heighten the fantastical or comical effects of the final artistry that you immerse yourself in. We wanted to make it a very photoreal environment to begin with. So that kind of dictated the path of using photogrammetry through Reiner's company, Realtra, so that the user feels super immersed in a real, you know, what's ostensibly like a real bedroom that this girl grew up in. And we used 8i for capture so that you can actually walk around the characters, and it's more akin to live theater than anything else, because although the action is on rails for the first part of the experience, you can take any vantage point that you want. And it's interesting to see people go through the experience because, you know, depending on where you're standing and the angle that you take, you have a different perspective on the experience and almost empathize differently with the two characters in the scene. So that's been fascinating to watch. And once we landed on those two elements, we wanted to add interactivity as well, because just to back it up a little bit, this project started from a studio grant through the Entertainment Technology Center, and what they wanted to understand was, how do you capture real physical assets and bring them into an interactive VR experience? So what's beyond 360 video if you want your real actors and your real sets in the experience? And so after building all those real elements and baking them in, we also added some gamified interactivity where the user can transform the space around them and turn it from this very photoreal environment into a totally surreal, psychedelic, trip that I encourage you all to go check out.
Yeah. Who doesn't like a nice psychedelic trip every now and again?
We've gotten several comments about that, especially from the older crowd who was around for Woodstock.
So. And Scott, in any psychedelic trip, sound is so important, isn't it? But it does play, in this particular situation, even more so, right? Capturing the dynamics of the relationship between a mother and her daughter and then escaping into your own mind. Tell me a little bit about the role of sound. And Scott, I should congratulate you on just working through your first year here as heading up the sound lab at Technicolor. We're very excited about that.
Thank you. Yeah. Thank you. Woohoo. All right. So, you know, with audio and how audio plays a role in any project, I try to take each project, look at its uniqueness, and figure out, you know, how is sound going to help and what role does it play? So the obvious is we need to hear the dialogue, we need to hear presence, create presence, understand the reality of what we are seeing. So that's pretty straight ahead. The fun starts getting into the alter ego. Mm-hmm. Now we're creating a world that's not the reality, it's her world, it's her safe place. How does sound, and because it was also tied to comic books a little bit, I'm not giving anything away, that all of a sudden we could start introducing sounds that are a little fun and a little bit of who she is and where she's going and the kind of world that gives it an oral experience and it gives it a fantasy experience. Now all of a sudden, audio plays a bigger role. And exemplifying that and supporting that, where it's not only happened visually, but now it's happening with more than one sense. It's happening with audio. And being immersed into that, all of a sudden, just gives it a much more heightened form of entertainment.
It really does. So, Christine, back to you. It's such a clearly personal story and an emotional one. And we think of technology as being cold, right? Being a cold. How did you warm up to this? How did you warm up to going from telling a story and because you're an artist across many different mediums, how did you warm up to this as a way of expressing this very important story?
Well, I think I was warm from the minute they said go, the minute it was greenlit. And I think what really helped me was two things. Was originally being an artist that did art in different mediums, whether it was watercolor, sculpture, jewelry making, painting. I always knew that there was a way to express myself. I just had to learn how to use the tools. And then the other thing that I had was this great team that knew more than I did. And so I really was put in a position to go, well, I don't like this, and I don't like that, and I don't get this, and why can't we do that? And I had the support of people that really took the time to understand what I was trying to say and what I was trying to do. And the collaboration just got to the point where we just, when all the pieces fell together, it was just really natural that we finally had a piece and the pieces of technology to give the user agency and put them in that world instead of telling them a story and telling them something's wrong and telling them something's bad, having them actually be there and experience and react to it and participate in it, and then also participate in the arc of feeling better about it. So you get a full character arc, you get a full creative arc, you get your own experience while experiencing her experience. And it was all just from being an artist all my life and having a great team and support behind me.
Yeah. So, Scott, because I think of you as an artist as well as obviously a technologist who's pushing the boundaries of sound. How do you map that emotional connection to your mission as you try to bring sound, especially because you have a long track record in traditional flat screen environments? What was the key? What are the keys to bringing out that emotional connection when you're not in front of an experience, but you're inside, beyond the narrative sort of directional aspect of sound?
Yeah, you know, I know Christine and I spend a lot of time talking about sound and music, you know, source music, because the whole point of it was, how do we hear something, whether it be music, that automatically brings a memory? It brings an emotion like, oh, I remember that style. Or we talked about people talking on the other side of the wall. Things that she grew up with hearing. Things that people, when they hear certain things, automatically get a response like, oh, I remember that growing up as well, mm-hmm. something of that ilk. As well as just understanding the environment. And again, I think the artistry starts coming in the alternate reality and understanding the story of who she is inwardly as well as outwardly, and you know, who she has to be and who she is inside. And those are two big factors that, you know, as we use audio to try to play those dualities.
I think that the one moment I really enjoyed talking to you when you had asked me, okay, she's into comic books, and I go, oh no, it's way more than that. She's a cosplayer, she's into the games, she's into the movies, she's into everything, this, and you got it right away.
Yeah.
And that just made the possibilities richer and the bag of what we could reach for as far as sound goes, for especially the sound effects that you guys came up with.
I think it's important because I think everybody, you know, many people in the world have almost two faces. Mm-hmm. There's the face you go to work with, and then there's the weekend face. There's the child inside that some point you grew up. You don't know when you grew up, what day that was, or what age that was, but there's still that person who had the dreams and the wishes and what they wanted to be, and not what they had to be, what they wanted to be, what they fantasized to be, you know. And I think that's what this plays into it, not only about her, but I think that you can draw parallels to each individual who watches it and gets something out of it as, you know, I always wanted to be a rock star. I always wanted to be an artist. My parents or society thought that that was not good. Something in everybody that allows you to walk away with that, enjoy it, and then maybe think a little bit of what did you want to be? Who are you internally that it was never able to get out, or something of that ilk?
Yeah, and even if it's just for the moment in your bedroom or forever.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, Brian, so you can hear, I mean, there's a lot going on in just this conversation alone. So how do we capture that as we try to provide a canvas to reflect this inner and outer world in a medium that's in fact designed to put you inside of an experience and not look at it from the outside? What were the sensibilities that you brought to it as you were developing that experience at the Technicolor Experience Center?
An early question we had to answer for this experience was, should it be first person or third person? Which, you know, each one says something very different about your role in the experience. Mm-hmm. As well as, you know, who is Anne? Who is this person that Christine was characterizing in her script? And how did she want your relationship with her to be in the VR experience? And we considered a lot of first-person routes of, you know, looking in a mirror and seeing distorted body image and working with body dysmorphia in a more literal way. But ultimately, what was more important in our conversations was hitting the note of hope and escape and imagination. And so for that reason, we decided to go with a third person perspective where, you know, you understand Anne's struggle by witnessing it as like a silent bystander. Mm-hmm. And then you can actually contribute and take control of the situation to help her escape into her imagination.
So you become partners with the character, but with the...
Sure. Yeah, exactly. And in terms of the workflow that goes into that, you know, luckily it's all real-time rendered in Unity. Mm-hmm. And so it's pretty much the first platform that most new cutting-edge technologies and headsets come out with SDKs for. So it was easy, relatively, to bring all of these things together into one space and allow, you know, the photogrammetry elements and the ADI assets and the CG assets all to play together pretty natively, you know, with a little bit of wrangling. But I think that something like 90% of most VR experiences are built in Unity right now. Mm-hmm. I made that number up. It's close, though. but it's a great playground to prototype quickly, mm-hmm. to get it into people's hands and to see how it's being received and test new ideas, because it's much more akin to game design than traditional film production, which is something we learned along the way, I think. And understanding how an audience reacts to it is the best way to validate, you know, your hypotheses of what your piece will ultimately say or what people will try to do with it or what their instinct will be coming out of it.
Right, and Reiner, so from your perspective, what did this mean in terms of creating that surround environment, in terms of creating what is the mission to be consistent? Because there are a lot of very different feeling experiences in this environment. Tell me a little bit about how you manage that complexity.
Yeah, so we knew we have similar environments and locations like in the movie that you're going to shoot. And so the environment, the room was just the room where the movie was going to, the room that we're going to use for the movie. So how did that come together? Mm-hmm. I think maybe it's interesting what we discovered early on in the process when we did the rehearsal. What happened there, I think, was really helpful. And I don't know what our audience is really interested. You know, how much you even understand volumetric video at this point.
Well, why don't you describe it?
Just this is kind of difficult.
Why don't we not make any assumptions? Talk about volumetric video and how you brought that into this story.
Okay. Who has heard of 8i? Okay. Wow. Right. Okay. photogrammetry, is that something that people understand most? Okay, great.
Okay.
And so basically, there was a decision made that this was going to be a 6 degrees of freedom environment. So 6 degrees of freedom is something that people understand now, right? You can not just look around, you can move through the environment. And so based on that, you pick certain technologies to put the product together. And in a way, when you start working with these new technologies, then you understand the limitations of each technology, mm-hmm. kind of like each technology has some problem with that. So in our case, like the big challenge when you do anything volumetric, anything that is truly three-dimensional, is you generally have a data problem. No problem that there's so much stuff out there. So if you don't just capture a flat image of the world, then you end up with like a million times the data. So what do? You kind of reduce it to what is important. And there's lots of technologies out there, but one of the main problems that hasn't been solved yet is temporal compression. Mm-hmm. So I don't know if I lost some people here, maybe. But no. It's like temporal compression, of course, you have that in JPEG and in video, but in volumetric stuff, you really don't have it. So we kind of did that manually. Okay, so temporal compression means that everything that doesn't move doesn't need to move. So we said it's going to be the room is not going to move. The room is just going to be the environment, the room is going to be, in our case, it was going to be a photogrammetry recreation of the real room that was going to be dressed like the room in the short movie. We actually had to dress it a little bit more than, but I can maybe talk about that in a moment, which was also interesting to kind of understand what you have to do slightly differently. And then the other thing was like everything that's in motion, that's another thing. So that's in the volumetric video. Because you really only want to have things like captured with video that are constantly in motion. Otherwise, you're using a lot of bandwidth for other stuff. So you break it up. And you break it up really quite drastically. You don't even shoot it together. You shoot the room and you shoot the performers on a stage, on a green screen stage. And you break it up even more. You don't even shoot the two performers together. So that's challenging. You know, you don't really think about it, how challenging that is, especially in Christine, in your case, you're working with non-actors. All right, well, that's really, really challenging because you have to imagine, you have to put them in a green screen stage where they're just surrounded by cameras, green screen, so there's nothing to perform with. You know, they're not feeling like they're in a room, they're not feeling like they're a mother or anything, they just feel like they're in a weird space maybe. And then they have to do continuous takes. So a non-actor has to do a good take with no cuts for like one and a half minutes or something. So very few people can pull that off, and I know that you kind of you understand how challenging that is, like the really like the production challenges are significant. So interesting thing that we discovered or we tried it out and was very useful was that when we did our rehearsal, at least we had like one of the performers for the rehearsal, and you worked with the actors. The actress, and we had a stand-in, and then once we kind of knew what was going to happen in this room, and the room was not dressed yet, I asked the performers to just stand still for 10 minutes, and I walked around and took photographs of the room. So very quickly, I took about 150 photographs of the room. And then, of course, there's software available now that you can feed these photographs into, and you have a volumetric representation of the room plus the actors. It's not good quality, but you can basically share it right away on destinations on Steam, and in theory, you could have a meeting in VR the same day and discuss the room and discuss everything else. And that is really, really powerful. I don't think we nearly use it as much as you could use it, but we used it later on, of course, we used it at the shoot. So first of all, you can get a really good kind of stand-in of the room that was not dressed. And then when you go to the green screen stage, when you work with the actors on a green screen stage, you can put, as we did, you can put the actors in the VR experience and they can then envision it before they go on the green screen stage, because then they really have to envision everything. And I think that helped them, you know, just seeing the other, okay, there's going to be another person, it's going to be this far away from them, they're on the ground, they're going to do this and this and that, and there's going to be a bed here, and there's going to be a wall there, and there's going to be the door, and everything is still going to be a challenge because they have to go through so many steps then and mime a lot of things. But I think it was helpful, and I would recommend doing it in the future, like if you shoot with AI.
So we've been talking, Christine, from your perspective, from the writing perspective and the story that you wanted to tell. The directing would be an interesting to get your perspective, given this, that you're filming people outside of the context of the very story that you're trying to tell. How did you give direction? How did you manage that?
Well, from the moment that we got the green light on this, we had, I think, a month and a half to prepare, and that's with all of us working full-time jobs and then getting this ready. So we had 6 weeks to prepare a film shoot and a VR shoot. And also with actors that aren't even here. I fought really hard to keep the authenticity of Thai actors and Thai-American actors by finding Thai people. And that's why we had to shoot with non-actors. And then a week before we shot, the Thai king died. And I lost a lot of my sort of experienced Thai actors. And so we ended up having to get the actual mother of the actress who played the daughter volunteered. And I was like, I'm going to be really, really hard on you. But we've got to... And she wanted to do whatever it could to tell this story because her and her daughter are going through the same struggles that I went through with my mother. And it never crossed my mind, and I had never directed theater before. But after my experience of prepping and directing at ADI, I really could see that if I had to do this again, that the best way to work and rehearse with the actor and to prepare the actor, or maybe even in casting, is to consider theater actors. So that was one of the things as a director that was not just a challenge, but a really great experience. I was doing VR for the first time. I was doing this new, you know, different way of approaching working with actors for the first time. The weird thing was that when we went to go shoot the movie, because we prepped for the VR, and then we went off to start the movie, it seemed like to them, after preparing for the VR, doing these partial takes for the movie was so easy. So they were more comfortable after having to try to do a full-on perfect take.
You know, and we're seeing a lot of... a lot of combos where a movie's associated with the VR experience and so on. We're going to be making some announcements on that shortly ourselves. But how do you feel, Brian, about the trend there? And I'd like to hear from Scott on this too, of just sort of integrating these two experiences part of a package, right? That the VR experience, whether it becomes before or after the release of a work of art. How do you correlate those, and how do you maintain some kind of continuity?
I think it's very exciting because, you know, stories are best told across multiple mediums, and each medium can offer up unique things and visceral experiences that, you know, are even more engaging. So it just kind of deepens fandom for different stories and allows for different avenues of experiencing these characters. I think, you know, the important thing is ultimately understanding the unique affordances of each medium and designing the experience around that. right now it seems like a lot of them are just kind of marketing plays, and I'm excited for, you know, what I think will be the near future, where it really is deep story development in VR and AR and mixed reality alongside the linear experiences,
yeah.
And allowing more of a crossing over of those two worlds in a sustained way akin to television. I know, you know, sci-fi has done some early experimentation with that, and I hope to see a lot more of that.
What does that mean for sound, Scott? I mean, you know, you're working on a big film or even a more intimate project, and it, the sound has to connect in both environments. What are your thoughts on maintaining that?
I mean, I love it. I've had two experiences in the last, I don't know, X amount of years. One was Pacific Rim, where I did the movie and I also did the VR experience. We got a chance to be inside the con pod and see what it's like. And it was great because one of the things that audio does for VR, which is different than movies and TV, is it becomes a navigational tool. Mm-hmm. So at one point, the gel comes down, like you see in the movie, but you are the pilot. And you go in and you look at the earmuff, you look at the gears. Next thing you know, Charlie Hunnam's next to you. Mm-hmm. And he goes, hey, look over here. Mm-hmm. And you look over there. And now we're going to navigate. Then there's a beep over there, knife heads coming in, and you experience a training mission of what it would be like to be in Gypsy in that. I had another one that wasn't VR-based, which was actually quite fun. It was Chronicles of Riddick. So we did the anime, the movie, and the video game, Riddick and Butcher Bay, which went on to be very, very popular. Mm-hmm. And we did that all at once. What's great is you start creating an audio mythology of what these environments are, what's the history, and it's just great because as an audio person, I immerse myself into the projects I'm in. I eat, live, and breathe it. And when you get a chance to work within multiple mediums and to tell a longer story, it's just so much fun. And it's in some ways it's more fulfilling because you get a chance to really explore what's the character like, where's the environments like, are there any adversary creatures, yada, yada, yada. And of course, you know, you end up living with it. Pacific Rim, I was on for 2 years, and Chronicles of Riddick, I was on for about a year and a half.
Yeah. Let me, by show of hands, how many creative storytellers do we have in the audience? And then how many of you would you consider yourselves technologists primarily versus storytellers, by show of hand? So you, and it's so funny how people pick up their hands twice. All right, I'd like to, I want to ask a question, Christine. I'd like someone to volunteer to give their answer to this. But Christine, my question is this. Now that you've done this, now that you've created the, you know, this series, right, these series of experiences in two different mediums, what is your, how do you plan to move forward from here now that you've had this? How does this affect the way you think about a story that you want to tell when you know you have these multiple options coming up?
Well, in an odd way, I was thinking like that already, but from a script point of view. So Simon and I, we write features, but we also write television. So when you're thinking about television, you're thinking of all these episodes, all these arcs, all these maybe backstories and, you know, season one, season two, season three. And it really is no different from that other than instead of episodes, you're thinking about different platforms. Mm-hmm. And it almost feels like when you start writing to learn how to screenwrite, they always tell you, this is not a novel. You don't have to tell them everything. Mm-hmm. And then I think that with all these platforms now, it's come from, there's so many awesome places you can go in a novel that a feature or an episode of television, the audience can't tolerate within that amount of time. And then now I think that this weird thing has happened that we've gone back to sort of a novel where the stories are richer, fuller, there's more threads, and I'm getting goosebumps just
because yeah. I don't excited. Read novels.
It opens up the ideation process, right?
It
allows you to brainstorm freely and slot in the ideas to the appropriate
medium.
And
if this doesn't work in the movie, we could do that in the VR.
Right, that's part of the vernacular, right? You leave it on the cutting room floor, right? We still have to do that. Now you have a home for that content that you never wanted
nothing
to lose.
Nothing gets thrown away.
Did you have a point you were going to make on that, Scott?
No, I was going to say that, you know, what's interesting is happening in entertainment right now is you had TV, and I mean to be bad, but that was made for 12-year-olds to be able to understand once upon a time. movies were always much more sophisticated, much more complex, complex characters and stuff like that. Now, what's happening into this age of content on demand, which is also interesting with VR because it's going to get there. Mm-hmm. But now we've got Netflix, we have HBO, we have Amazon. Now, we're going back to, like you were saying, like a novel, now we can tell stories over 30 hours, 40 hours. This is getting really fascinating because when you do a movie and you gotta get it done in 90 minutes, what I always hear from directors are, yeah, because we always cut bigger films. Films are much, much longer. I worked on Kill Bill, and the first version was 4 hours, and they said, we can't put out a four-hour movie. How about we make two movies? So it's very interesting of where it's going now with content on demand, where you can do these long, integrated stories, and people love them. I think it's a wonderful art of storytelling, and then to be able to experience it is also a fascinating situation where sometimes you want to adjust on TV, but sometimes it'd be really cool to be there. Yeah. I think Colony is doing that on a TV show that you can then play a virtual kind of video game of what it would be like. And again, everyone's just tickling the sources of it now. Mm-hmm. But what I'm so excited about is what could be.
Right.
I mean, it's opened up where the distribution medium now is the internet.
Yeah.
And it's no longer three TV studios and six big movie studios. Now to get your product out there, everything's changing.
It's a counterintuitive observation, and you don't think of long form art in VR. I mean, it's like it's been, you know, we've thought of it in the opposite, but in that context, it could very well.
I mean,
be
if
part
you think about like South Park, was actually a little short to the Tracy Ullman show, and then all of The Simpsons, and all of a sudden, bam, it took off in a big way. And same thing, South Park was a little internet piece that came out. It was Santa versus Jesus. Mm-hmm. And next thing you know, bam, it goes viral.
All right, so if you have a story to share on how you would see a multimedia, multidimensional perspective on storytelling, I don't know if anybody wants to do that. But any questions or comments in the time that we have remaining, I'm happy to entertain, and I'll stop asking questions. I have plenty more, though. Any questions or comments? Yes, ma'am, in the back. Yes.
Sorry, a little nervous.
Don't be nervous. We're all friends here.
Hello. So how was your approach to storytelling in VR, since it's such an immersive experience and there isn't necessarily a linear path that you need to follow because it's just experiential of how you're viewing this new reality? What was your approach to this?
We actually wrote two scripts. The first one is very much like a regular script and was told in the way of more of the atmosphere, feeling, the tone. And then we went back and rewrote that in a way that was very point-by-point technical. Because we're still at that point, we're looking for supporters and helping us build this project. So if we show them the first script, they get the world of the story and fall in love or be attracted to the story. But then when the question goes, well, how are you technically going to do this? It's like, well, here's the script. Mm-hmm. And so we really did approach it in a very traditional way. But at that point that we started writing, we had talked so much, researched so much, and had built and torn away so many elements that we knew, okay, this is the part that we're writing for regarding the photogrammetry. This is the part we're writing for regarding the animation. All those things were made clear, were on our minds when we wrote the traditional script and then literally in the technical script.
You know, but what's implied in that excellent question is there a difference between presenting an experience or creating an opportunity for experience versus storytelling?
I think there isn't, only in the sense of you are presenting an experience anyway when you're, if you're writing, I don't know how to write a movie correctly, but if I assume I'm trying to tell the best story in the right way, if you're not trying to literally manipulate people with tricks, you're building an experience for them to be in, a world for them to be in, characters for them to get to know. All those come with the tricks of cinema. Mm-hmm. And writing, and what are you doing with the camera? What are you doing with sound? A screenwriter is thinking about mise-en-scene no matter what, and the technology that comes along with that mise-en-scene, that you're going to do the same thing, I think. And that's just for me, mm-hmm. coming to this as a first-time VR writer-director from doing cinema and television, that really wasn't any different to me. As long as you are aware of the world and the order that you're going in and the tools that you have at hand.
One last question. Anybody? Yes, ma'am, over here.
Hi, Christine. It's Carolyn.
Yeah. Hey.
Hey. My question is, when you're writing
She's
for...
in the movie.
I am. I'm an extra. My question is, when you're writing for like your separate script for the VR experience, do you still consider the beats you're going to make? And if you are, how do you engage the audience or direct their view, because it's so like open-ended? How do you make them still experience the certain story that you want them to, unless it's totally open-ended?
This is a great question, because we had to approach it in two different ways. So the first half of the experience is literally a scene, two actors playing out in front of you. The second half of the experience is more like a video game. And I forgot to mention that too, like in the question of do you approach things differently, I had to really like sink into the mind of what would it be like to write a video game also. But in the end, everything was always about what are the emotional beats, and even if in doing an action, what kind of emotional beat is going to keep you engaged. And the whole time we were always thinking, how do you keep someone engaged as you're feeding them all these little Easter eggs? So for the actors, it really had, has everyone ever heard of writing in a lean forward, for leaning forward, where it's like, yeah, very cause and effect, like everything that's written there is for a reason. And specifically in a 2-minute scene that is really a downer, like you're basically sitting there with your friend and her mother comes in and mm-hmm. crushes the day. So the conversation has to be in a way that it was engaging you. And I really hoped that it would cause an environment where the user is being engaged, because they are now becoming the director. They are becoming the camera. They are becoming the person who decides, am I looking at one people? Am I close up? Am I medium? Are they both in it? We wrote the dialogue and the confrontation between the two characters specifically and hoping that it would engage and lean the user in. And then also with, after they disappear and you're in the room alone, with the thoughts of what do we have at hand for sound design? What do we have at hand for whether it was animation or the graphics? Because there's a whole room and there's 6 points in the room that you have to get to and do different things that have to do with this character's world. But we're not all Thai American. We're not all into comic books. How is our interest even drawn into that? So we really were thinking of always keeping you engaged, leaning forward, and always had to ask, is this even fucking interesting? Are they even, at this point, are they just gonna put it down and take, I've taken the headset off. I've been in a piece where I just didn't wanna do it anymore. It was really always on our minds how to keep you engaged, and also keeping in mind what is the arc of what we're trying to, and hoping that you will go through in the end.
Sadly, I actually have abused my time. I'm a little bit over, but it says time's up, in fact. Look at that in red. can I have a round of applause for my awesome panel? Thank you very much. I really sure do hope that this is not the end of the session, that this is the beginning of a conversation that you can have with this wonderful panel. And I think it's wonderful to see these brilliant people from both the technological and the creative areas of our brains come together. Thank you very much, panel. I really appreciate you, and I hope we get a chance to do this again. Thank you all very
much.
Thank
you, Lane. Thank you, everyone.
Hope you enjoy your VR LA experience.